From WBUR Boston, I'm Tom Ashbrook, and this is On Point. Charles Murray knows how to put a stick in the American beehive. He did it by race, IQ, and class in his 1994 The Bell Curve. It got him called the most dangerous conservative in America. This time, he's subtracted race, sort of, by just talking about whites, white America. But class division in America? Bigger than ever, he says, and not just by money. The country is coming apart, he says, over values. This hour on Point, let the debate begin. We're looking at Charles Murray's latest troubled take on America. You can join the conversation. Is this country now irrevocably divided by class and brains and faith and virtue? Or is that an un-American fatalism? You can comment at our website, onpointradio.org, or on Twitter and Facebook at On Point Radio. We begin today in Washington with Charles Murray. He's a senior fellow at the American Enterprise Institute and author of the new book, Coming Apart, The State of White America, 1960 to 2010. Charles Murray, welcome to On Point.
Thank you, Tom.
What's your thesis, sir?
The thesis is that we have developed classes over the last 50 years that are different in kind from anything we've known before. You know, we've always had rich people and we've always had poor people. They've always lived in different parts of town. But there was a common civic culture that bound them in terms of some basic institutions that have deteriorated very badly over the last 50 years, specifically for one group, namely the white working class. And secondly, there has been a new upper class develop, which is increasingly isolated from and ignorant of the rest of America. That's pretty much the thesis.
Why are you focusing on white Americans in this book?
It concentrates my reader's attention. But when you're talking about social problems, whether it's breakdown of marriage or unemployment or whatever, there's always in the back of one's mind, well, to what extent is this a national problem? To what extent is it focused, say, in the black community or the Latino community or whatever? And by just referring not only to non-Latino whites, but really most of my numbers are about people ages 30 to 49 within that group, it clarifies a lot of the issues. You know, race is out of the question. We're talking about problems that affect all of America, but they aren't going to be cured by getting rid of the legacy of slavery or by restricting immigration.
What are the indicators that you're looking at? The sort of statistical profiles. You got 1960 and 2010 in your title here. Give us the parameters.
Marriage is the most dramatic. 1960, in the upper middle class, and I define that as being college educated, working in the professions or in managerial positions, 94% were married of the 30 to 49-year-olds. 84% of the white working class were married, working class meaning a high school diploma only and working in a blue-collar job. 84% of them. So you had an overwhelming norm in both parts of the American hierarchy. You fast forward to 2010. For the upper middle class, you're looking at 84%, which is still a very high number. For the white working class, you're looking at 48%. That's a minority. That is the collapse of a central cultural institution. I also go through the same kind of exercise for industriousness, for honesty, and for religiosity.
So you're saying white Americans, white working class Americans, are no longer religious, industrious, or virtuous?
That's, Tom, a little bit of an oversimplification. No, I'm saying there has been a divergence on all four of those, with the white working class being increasingly no longer participating in some basic institutions. Take unemployment, for example, and drop out from the labor force. Again, the norm for males in 1960 was, if you're 30 to 49 years old, you better be quadriplegic before you aren't in the labor force. That was just a compelling social norm. It remained so in the upper middle class. In the white working class, you now have about one out of eight who are not even looking for work. And these are not numbers I'm getting after the recession hit. And this is a point I have a feeling we're going to be arguing about a lot today. This deterioration was just as rapid or more rapid during the boom years that we have experienced in the 1980s and the 1990s and parts of the 2000s. You cannot say, there are no jobs out there. That explains it. It just doesn't fly.
So there's marriage, there's employment or industriousness, as you would have it. What about religion and your founding virtues, as you call them, taking them back
to...
Yeah,
the founding virtues, that phrase I used, you know, actually initially in the book I was calling them the Republican virtues, referring to the old-fashioned use of the word republic, and I said, no, I can't do that. So I changed them to founding virtues. The founders were unanimous in saying that if you're going to have a limited government in which people run their own lives, you must have a certain kind of populace. You must have, in the words of Madison, virtue in the people. And the founders were unanimous about a few things that you had to have. One of those was industriousness. Another one was what they called marital morality, which really refers to the institution of marriage. Third was plain American honesty. And the fourth was religiosity. And even someone like Thomas Jefferson, who was a deist, said, yeah, you must have religiosity in the people as part of the self-governing moral compass that they have. So the surprising one to me was religiosity, because, like everybody else, I've thought that religion was strongest in the working class and sort of diminished as you went up the ladder. In fact, if you talk about people who both attend church regularly and say they have a strong affiliation with their faith, that's dropped throughout the society over the last 50 years. It's dropped the most dramatically in the white working class. So now you're down to about 12% of the white working class adults who meet that definition of a strong affiliation and attending regularly. That was a surprise to me.
So step back and paint the picture then of this America that you're describing here, where you've got a, what do you call it, a narrow elite.
Narrow and a broad elite.
Oh, all right.
In fact, Tom, let me just clarify something, because this can get confusing. I've been talking about upper middle class and working class. Now if we're moving on to the elites, that's a subset of the upper middle class, small subset.
Well, we'll leave it with your broad stroke here, but just step back and look at this country and what it means. If your statistical profile is correct, and if there's a gulf not only then in affluence but in values, if that's right, what does that mean?
It means the end of America as we have known it. It doesn't mean we become less powerful. It doesn't mean we become economically less rich. The United States has had a civic culture which was seen as exceptional around the world. It had many aspects of uniqueness, but we aren't the only people to see that think we were exceptional. The degree to which Americans came together to solve their problems, and the degree to which there was contact across classes. So that here's a quick way of expressing it, Tom. If you went to a really wealthy suburb in 1960, you know, the top of the line, you know, the richest parts, Brookline in Boston, North Shore of Chicago and so forth, you were looking at a median income those days of $84,000 in today's dollars, which is not affluent for a median. The more important thing, you're only looking at 25% of those populations in those kinds of suburbs who had college degrees. So you had people who've been successful, but they came out usually of working class families or middle class families, only rarely from upper middle class families themselves. So at every level of American society, there was still a lot of direct experience with all the classes, and that's changed a whole lot.
You say it's the end of America as we've known it. That's pretty bad, pretty gigantic.
That's pretty gloomy.
In itself. Pretty gloomy. But you have a kind of apocalyptic forward throw off that, saying, you know, that you can't keep harmony in a country like this, the country with a canyon in the middle of it like you're describing.
Yeah, I think both the Tea Party and the Occupy movement were expressing in different ways some of the sense that there is an elite out there now. I know the Occupy movement to put it in terms of the top 1% in income, but in fact, I think there's a common sense of an elite that sort of runs things to suit itself, whether it's crony capitalism, whether it's political elites who think they know best and can tell people what to do from the Tea Party's point of view. And I think that expresses the sense, you know what, the people who run the country are increasingly divorced from the rest of the country. And I think there's a lot of merit in that argument.
And what about the argument that though you frame this in terms of morals, it is, even though your statistics predate the collapse of 08, it is really about money. Entry-level wages for male high school graduates down 23% since 1973. That there's a long-running trend here that is putting people over a barrel in a way that makes it harder for them to live that virtuous, tidy American life that you'd like to see. That it's money first, said, not morals first.
Tom, you can say the entry-level wage is down 23% from its high point, which was 1973. But if you take a look at the baseline of 1960, all right, you often hear people say, oh, men used to be able to make a family wage in the working class, and they can't do that anymore. The mean earnings in 1960 from the same working class jobs that I used throughout the time series was the same in 1960 and 2010. It was actually quite a lot more in 2008, but it went down after the recession. The point is that we can talk about the problems associated with a failure of income to rise in the working class, and that's a perfectly legitimate point of view. You can't say, oh, guys could afford to get married back then and they can't now. That's just not true. There was no such thing as an affluent working class that is no longer affluent.
Last time out, you were Mr. Abolish Social Welfare. Is that still your answer to what you're describing?
Well, I'm a libertarian. So my solution to everything is to get the government out of it.
I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point, and we're talking this hour with lightning rod libertarian, social critic Charles Murray about his dire warning of America, white America, cracking up by class, elites and others. His new book is Coming Apart, The State of White America, 1960 to 2010, and you can really project right on beyond white America as he describes it here. Charles Murray joins us today from Washington. Also with us today from San Francisco is Joan Walsh, editor-at-large for Salon.com. Her review, Charles Murray Does It Again, was published at Salon.com. You can find a link at our website, onpointradio.org. Joan Walsh, thank you very much for being with us. What do you make of Mr. Murray's thesis this time?
Tom, thanks for having me. You know, I think that liberals should read this book. I think it contributes a couple of really interesting things. And any time that we're forced to really examine our ideas about poverty and opportunity in this country, that's a good thing. But, you know, I find it hard to believe that this book is being treated as something brand new and original and different, because really, this is some of the oldest thinking about poverty and work in human history, really. This goes back to poor houses. This goes back to poor laws. This notion that the poor and the struggling, it's not just the poor anymore, it's now the white working class, my people, by the way. Mm. The white working class, they just don't work as hard. They aren't as smart. They just don't have the right morals. And therefore, if you help them in any way, if you provide any kind of social support for them, you're hurting them, because really the only answer for them is to work their tails off from birth until death. It's social Darwinism. It's really nothing new.
What about the statistical, what Charles Murray puts forward as kind of moral collapse that he's pointing to?
Well, I was really aghast at that, to be honest with you. I mean, if you look at Wall Street, if you look at the capacity of people at the top to indulge in antisocial values and be rewarded for them. Mr. Murray, to his credit, you know, sometimes he seems to bend over backwards to be fair about this, and he goes looking for perhaps signs of moral decay in some of what went on in Wall Street. But he really can't find it, he says. He doesn't like the huge rise in CEO compensation. It's unseemly. But he doesn't really see that as the rules being rigged against the rest of us. And I think the other interesting thing, I mean, we could argue statistics all day, and we could have statistics on both sides. But one thing that I'd like to talk about that gets this maybe to a higher ground is the bracket that he puts on this set of problems from 1960 to 2010, it's interesting. But if you really look at the entire 20th century, just step back a bit, what we really saw after the Depression and after World War II was a deliberate decision by elites and by policymakers and by politicians to flatten income inequality, to create opportunities for the working class to rise, and frankly, to limit some of the capacity of the highest, the richest people to concentrate their wealth.
You're talking in the heart of the 20th century, the sort of happy days era.
The happy days, exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, the world into which I was born, frankly. Mm. Things were created for me. Things were created for people born, for the baby boomers, a lot of us. And a world was put in motion that was supposed to work, where hard work was rewarded. You know, it was patriarchal in some ways. There was a family wage. There was a notion that a man should be able to work his whole life for the same company, bring home a decent wage, his wife could stay home and take care of the children. That world either fell apart or was taken apart. We can argue about exactly what happened. But that was the world that created a certain kind of stability and social structure. And that world came apart. The idea that the decline in male wages, the decline in median male wages, the decline in entry-level male wages doesn't have any influence on these social changes that we're seeing, I don't see how that's possible.
I'll take that to Charles Murray, but just one question on the statistics here. I mean, you can say you can argue about statistics all day, but here's just for one, here's this marriage rate, which has dropped kind of in half to under 48% for the lower class that Charles Murray is writing about. I mean, it's hard to argue about that. Is that a big deal to you, that there's less marriage? I mean, Rick Santorum, for example, puts it at the center of his campaign for the GOP nomination for the presidency. Charles Murray takes that as an indicator of, you know, a social, cultural collapse. It is certainly a big change.
It is certainly a big change, and none of us understand it, and we could argue about it all day. Mr. Murray and I believe we've both been divorced once. So, you know, people make decisions. Personal lives are very complicated, and we all understand that. I think the really interesting thing is, you know, I've been reading Mr. Murray since the 80s when I was doing anti-poverty work, and a lot of his conclusions in his book Losing Ground, which was groundbreaking, had to do with the role of welfare in a decaying family structure, and particularly in the black community. You know, if you go back to Daniel Patrick Moynihan in 1965, he was saying that he was sounding the alarm about a quarter of black families were led by single moms. That has now spread into the white working class, the white lower middle class, even to some extent the middle class. What does that mean? I mean, I don't know. I know we're not supposed to say we don't know, but I don't know. But I would say that liberals come at this and say something that was going on with the black family, perhaps the decline or the disappearance in opportunities for men who didn't have college educations or even high school educations, perhaps the decline of jobs and the instability of family life for black people that was put forward by slavery, frankly, and continued by discrimination over the years, those were the things that made it hard for black family life to flourish. Well, now we're seeing the same things happen in white working class family life. Is it really that white people's morals have changed? Or could it be that actually the economy is not rewarding the kinds of behavior that it used to reward and is instead rewarding greed and arrogance at the very top? Could that be what happened?
Charles Murray, I want to bring that to you. Let me get a couple of our listeners in here first, if I may. From New York, DePoister, New York, Sheila is calling. Sheila, thanks for calling. You're on the air.
Hi. I was just wanted to comment that Mr. Murray is worried about oversimplification of his views, and I find it that these are old views. I mean, there's nothing new here. I know in the 60s that people couldn't always make it, but that's what the programs were for, to help them get educated, to help them move up that way. And I'm white. I'm married to one man all this time. I have two children. We work hard. You know, and I'm, you know, I'll never write a book or get rich that way, and I'm not asking to be extremely wealthy. I'm asking that I have a decent living, my family has a decent living, my children can go on to something hopeful.
Are you confident of that? Have you been moving up in these last decades?
No, but we've kind of been moving sideways. We haven't been going down, but we've been moving sideways. And I think he oversimplifies the thought that just somehow being married or being at an upper level gives you the higher moral ground. I know a lot of people, and I'm from a rural area, so you get to know people intimately, and that is not always the case.
Sheila, let me take it to Charles Murray, and thank you very much for your call. Charles, there's Sheila. She's doing the right thing by your lights. You know, married, family, going nowhere. I mean, how do you apply this values collapse to somebody like Sheila? And she looks around kind of generously and says, I know people who have different family structures, but, you know, you're wrong to just say they're bankrupt morally.
Tom, I don't say they're bankrupt morally. In fact, the use of the word moral in the book of, I've been trying to think how many times it's in there. let me try to express why something like the breakdown in marriage has a lot to do with important things, regardless of whether you're liberal or conservative.
Take up Sheila's circumstance first. She's calling in, and she's married, and she has a family, and she's gone nowhere.
And she said, no, wait a minute. She was not telling us a tale of misery and failure and so forth. But Tom, after hearing the book characterized the way it's been characterized, I think I've got to correct something. First, this book is not about causes. I deliberately did not write about causes, except with the formation of the new upper class. There I talk some about causes. In terms of the formation of the new lower class, I don't. And there's a reason for that. I want this book to be one that can be read by people on the left as well as the right without throwing the book against the wall. I want them to contemplate the nature of the problem. And so let's talk about why the family marriage falling to 48% in the white working class is a big deal. It's not because of some abstract moral precept. It is because, among other things, the family is a huge source of social capital in communities. You know, the people who end up coaching the little league teams and being in the PTA and participating in attempts to solve community problems overwhelmingly are married people. That's something that's the way it works out, whether you're talking about Robert Putnam's Bowling Alone, which describes that, or any other analysis of social capital. When you have disappearing marriage, you have eroding social capital in communities. Same thing goes for religiosity. Same thing goes when you have large numbers of men no longer participating in the labor force.
But why do you stick with that perspective?
It affects the lives that people leave.
I understand that, and I accept that may be true, but then to your larger thesis, here we have a caller who says she's not moving. She's moving sideways. She's not moving up.
Well, wait a minute. She wasn't saying that her great motive in life is to move up. She said, you know, she did not say, we're suffering, we've had...
That's everybody's motive.
Wait a minute.
That's everybody's
motive. We both listen. We've had the listeners heard her call, I heard her call, and you heard her call. And I don't think that she was talking about a life in which she's miserable. I think she was complaining about me not giving adequate recognition to the values and virtues of people like her.
Even the ears work differently. It's very interesting. Let me get one more. Clover, Morgantown, West Virginia. Clover, you're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Hi, Tom. Thanks.
Hi. Yeah.
I just wanted to speak to the idea that you mentioned briefly earlier about the sort of new upper class, I think, the professionals, the college-educated, being sort of elite and isolated, I think was the word you used,
yes.
or Mr.
Yes.
Murray used.
Mm-hmm.
And
yes.
I just wanted to address that because as somebody with a terminal college degree, something that might kill you, right? I would fall into that category, I'm sure.
Okay.
And I live in West Virginia, and I just want to say that I think this idea that elites are isolated really depends on where you are geographically.
Absolutely.
If I was to try to be elitist... and only associate myself with other people that have my level of education or that's very bad, I'd be very lonely where I live.
So in Morgantown, it's not going to happen. Clover, let us hold that. That's a really interesting perspective. And let me put it up against one from Buffalo, New York, if I may. Thanks for calling, Clover. But Charles, you're on the air.
Yes, how you doing? Growing up in Buffalo 50 years ago, there was only one street. His name was LeBron, the city where all the absolute elite lived. And families would get in their car on Sundays and drive down it just to see how the other half lived.
Yep.
Now, none of us were jealous. We all lived fairly okay because there was plenty of jobs in the steel mills, and almost everyone could still afford a vacation somewhere for a week. Then was back to work for the next 51, but we were all relatively content. Now in Buffalo, there are 50 streets that make that original LeBron Street tail. But conversely, almost a third of Buffalo is a ghetto now, whereas 50 years ago, there was maybe a 20-square-block area that was ghetto. We're the third poorest city in America. You know, the bottom line is this, in my opinion, You just can't give a person a job. You got to give them a good paying job or a fair paying job where you can pay the mortgage, the car, the utilities, and still have a little bit left. That's all we're asking for in America. I don't know how those jobs ever come back to us, but I think that's the problem. And I think that this $7.25 an hour is an absolute insult to the American citizen.
Charles, we got it. Let me take all that to Charles Murray and then to Joan Walsh as well. There you've got Morgantown, where Clover can't disassociate herself from the rest of the country, though she feels herself an elite. Charles, you hear his description of what's happened in Buffalo, ghetto and high living, and the twain don't meet like they used to.
Yeah, there's a lot to agree with in both callers. And particularly, I think that the woman in Morgantown says it exactly right. It depends on where you live. If you live in Morgantown, I live in Burkittsville, Maryland, and I don't have a problem being isolated either. But if you, say, are living in Northwest Washington, you basically Washington, D.C., mm-hmm. Yeah. You are living in zip codes, contiguous zip codes, that have a combination of education and income that is matched by 5 out of 1,000 of other Americans. And these are large enough areas that you can live your life basically around people just like you. This doesn't bother me so much for the people who are first generation in these elites. It bothers me more and more for the second and third generations who have never known any other environment except this rather rarefied and isolated environment in which a whole variety of cultural norms are different from the rest of America. And everything from the amount of television you watch to the way you raise your kids, to the foods you eat, to the way you take care of your body.
And you say the norms are better in the upper or the elite class.
Nope, not on this one, okay? When I'm talking about marriage, industriousness, religiosity, and honesty, okay, those are across the board. These cultural differences mostly are not matters of better or worse, but different. But they are quite different. And so you have increasingly people who run the country, who have enormous influence over the lives of other people, who have had extremely little experience with the way most Americans live.
Joan Walsh, do you see that? Do you see an isolation that whatever their perspective on the challenges facing this country may leave some of this country's more affluent, better educated people just not aware of what realities are?
You know, I do agree with that, and I actually have to say that I think that the most important part and the most interesting part of Mr. Murray's book was where he goes into this very data-driven analysis of what he calls super zips, super zip codes, where people not just in that zip code, you know, are very affluent and went to college and often went to, he looks at people who came out of Ivy League colleges in particular, and he finds that the concentration of wealth concentrates itself from generation to generation. And that fits with my experience. You know, I went to the University of Wisconsin, and I went back to a reunion about a few years ago, and we sat around a table, and each and every one of us, from the person who went to Yale University to the person who went to a community college, said we would not have gotten into our universities with the kinds of test scores that we had back in the 70s and 80s. We just wouldn't have. And so I think this is very important. The question is, what do you do about it? And one thing that you haven't brought up, Tom, that I think is quite significant, is that Mr. Murray also believes in a kind of genetic determinism when it comes to issues of class and intelligence. He believes that the cognitive elite, the intelligent elite, is separating itself, and rightly so in certain ways. There's nothing we can do to stop that.
Tom Ashbrook, this is On Point, and we're talking this hour with libertarian social critic Charles Murray about his dire warning of America, white America up front, cracking up by class, elites, and others. The new book is Coming Apart, The State of White America, 1960 to 2010, and it has got a lot of debate going on. He joins us today from Washington. Joan Walsh is with us from San Francisco, editor-at-large for Salon.com. She's been reading and writing about Mr. Murray's work. Charles, Joan, a lot of response online here. Tom writes, the old social values, particularly religion, are largely defunct. The difference, he writes, is that the elites, quotation marks, have been able to replace them with more sustainable concepts of spirituality, service, thoughtful living. The underclass, meanwhile, and he seems to resonate with you, Mr. Murray, here a bit, absorbs the primary toxins from a sick popular culture via TV, internet, media, and finds community no longer in virtue-building custom, but in degenerative habit. On the other hand, William says on Facebook, you know, what about the trends that are going in good directions that aren't mentioned here? Rates of crime down, teen pregnancies down over this same period. You may be too quick to tar all this bad stuff on folks who aren't doing as well. Charles Murray, what do you say?
Well, unfortunately, the good news is mostly good news for the upper middle class and to some degree for the middle class, not for the lower class. Take crime, for example. Crime has gone down. That is good. But if you look at the experience in the white working class, it's still crime level still about 4 to 5 times what it was in 1960, down from about 6 times what it was, violent crime. So you've had crime fundamentally change the landscape in white working class communities, and that hasn't gone away. Teen pregnancies down, that's good. The proportion of children being born to single women now in the white working class is in the mid-40%, heading toward 50%. And meanwhile, in the upper middle class, it's still in single digits. So you have good news, which disproportionately benefits the upper middle class.
Let's look at, let's get a call here. Dubuque, Iowa. Ray, thanks for calling. Ray, you're on the air.
Hello, thanks for having me.
Yeah.
The thing I believe is that he has got a lot of valid points, but I'm not sure he's looking at all the contributing factors. There's been a lot of laws passed against the unions, and the unions used to have a large cross-reference of people. And when you start breaking down the unions, then, you know, companies that don't have unions pay good wages to keep the unions out. They give good benefits to keep the unions out, so it's competitive. I mean, they're making a living wage anyway without
the
union.
Yeah.
So when you start tearing the unions down, I mean, we're church-going, tax-paying backbone of America. And when you start tearing us down, then the whole country's going to go down with us.
You know, Ray, I appreciate your call very much. Charles, there, you know, Ray says you're sort of attacking right on us. You take away the structure that helps us make a living, and down we go.
Yeah, you know, as I was listening to him and as I was listening to Joan earlier, I was saying, you know, if we were both forbidden, if all of us were forbidden from talking about what got us into this mess and arguing about that, I think there would be a really interesting conversation. What Joan was saying about the isolation of the upper class, which she's observed, for that matter, it would be really interesting to have a conversation about what does it mean to have these dropping marriage rates and these dropping labor force participation rates, ignoring the causes, but what does it mean to community life? And I think we could have a really fruitful discussion. I'm not saying causes are unimportant, but I think that at this point we are where we are. And that toothpaste is not going back in the tube by any simple changes. And once we have the problem thoroughly understood, then we may be ready to talk about solutions. I'm not sure we're at that point yet.
But why not respond more materially to Ray's concern? He says, you know, laws were passed that made it harder for unions, and so you take away...
I will respond directly.
Why not reverse that get a living wage under more families, and maybe you'll see a change.
Tom.
Yes, I hear
The wages for the white working class have not gone down. If you take the median earned income, I'm talking about the basic current population survey, numbers that are available to everybody. They have not gotten richer over the last 50 years. But it is a myth that there was this family wage that's higher than working class people are making now. It's just not true.
It is not a myth, and especially if you, I think it's very interesting that you start in 1960, and I don't think that I'm not accusing you of bad faith in doing that, but if you start in 1973 and you flicked at that year, that's a very important year. That is when median wages start falling down. If you start in 1960, you absorb a lot of wage increase. We had a very booming economy. That economy worked for the working class, and it was when we began to pass laws making it harder to organize unions. I'm certainly not saying unions are the answer, but there really were changes in the economy that happened and that are very, very visible if your baseline is 1973 and not 1960.
I'm sorry,
we created a lot of low wage, no benefits.
Rates, Marriage rates were falling in the 1960s and early 1970s. Crime was increasing. There was dropout from the labor force that was beginning. There was drop in religiosity. All of the things I'm talking about were going on during this golden age that started to end in 1973, supposedly.
That's absolutely true. But there were also deeper changes in the economy that were already, when we couldn't see it, changing conditions for working class men, white and black. If you look at, if you start with 1973, it's not like something happened and the bottom fell out of the economy. It's not like it could not have happened right then that we started to see the real measurable, palpable changes right then. So, and you know, you called me Joan, I'll call you Charles. Charles, I just don't see, absolutely, thank you. I just don't see how we have a discussion about this without talking about causes. And I wish you would respond to my point about your views on IQ, because when I sat, I'm reading the book, and I'm going to tell you the point at which I was turning pages and thinking, wow, you know, Charles Murray and I might actually agree on something, was in the section about how basically people, wealthy people, super wealthy people go to Harvard. There's one statistic that I want to pull out and that I think we can agree is actually a bad thing. Right now, you say roughly 80% of the students admitted to these top tier Ivy League and super Ivies come from the top quartile of American families in terms of income. Only 2% come from the bottom quartile. And I was like, wow, you know, a few years ago, Berkeley started talking about socioeconomic affirmative action, because one thing that we've seen, those of us who care about racial justice, that affirmative action has not necessarily done that much for people at the very bottom of society. Poor African Americans are not attending Harvard in high numbers for sure. And poor whites don't get into these schools. What if we really talked about that? But as I kept turning the pages, Charles, I found this, what I call genetic determinism, because you're saying, well, you know, people, this cognitive elite, they're going to find ways to sort themselves and to concentrate themselves. Our economy is rewarding them. There's not a whole lot we can do about that. And when I get there, I don't know what to do. I know that my people, Irish Catholics, were believed to have very low IQ, and that our IQ has actually, our median IQ has changed over time. If we come down to basic genetic determinism, we really have a problem. We can't solve these problems.
Come on.
Well, that is what you describe, though, isn't it? You describe elites, cognitive elites, marrying one another, and off they go in higher numbers to super Ivies, et cetera. Isn't that your argument?
But can I point out that in the book, I didn't italicize the statement, but it's very explicit. I'm saying, look, there is a relationship, a statistical correlation between parental IQ and child's IQ. Whether it comes from genes or environment doesn't make any difference. The relationship exists. No, Joan, I'm saying what I said, not what you're saying.
Okay.
What I said is, look, if you have the statistical relationship and you have two people with IQs of 125 get married, they will have children, whether for genetic or environmental reasons, with IQs on average of X compared to people with IQs of 100 who have children. That's just simply a statistical relationship. It's a fact. And if it's 100% environmental, it's still a fact.
But isn't
it
also?
It's still a fact, but if it's, I'm sorry, Tom.
Well, it just sounds deterministic to me in a quite terrible way. I remember as a kid, my grandfather was a Swedish immigrant, and we lived in a rural area, a lot of Germans. And you tell me when I was a kid about a joke they used to tell, you know, what's the difference between a Swede and a bucket of manure? And the yuck answer was the manure. Or the bucket, excuse me, the bucket. In other words, Swedes just weren't, they just weren't up to snuff. They just weren't up to par.
What does that have to do with anything I've said?
Oh, well, because that was the popular view of the group that he and I, his grandson, belonged to. And we grew straight up out of that. There was nothing deterministic about it.
No, point number one is I'm talking about an empirical relationship that is not really contestable, okay, that exists for whatever reasons. The second point is that when you talk about mean outcomes, that's really important for understanding social dynamics. It is not determinism. So that if you take a population of people, the distribution of their children's IQs is going to be very wide. You have all sorts of people who are going to be really smart from parents who weren't so smart. You're going to have all sorts of people who aren't so smart from parents who are really
this
smart.
This sounds like an argument about permanent aristocracy.
The problem is that as we have more assortative mating, to use the technical term, whereby you have people who are marrying each other at the extremes, you get, on average, we're talking about means, you get, on average, increasing dispersion in the next generations, which is problematic. And I sympathize with Joan when she says accurately that I don't think a lot of these trends can be reversed. I think the economy is going to increasingly reward brains because that's the nature of a high-tech economy.
But isn't this an argument for more active exercise on the part of this country to make sure that the population is mixed up and that we don't get this kind of stratification? I mean, if the alternative is fatalistic, the America as we've known it comes apart, as you were saying, Charles.
Here's why I think the cause really does matter. Because if you don't, Charles in the book, I think, calls it intractable, if not innate. But if you believe that it really is subject to environment and subject to improved nutrition, all the things that happen as you rise, if you believe that IQ can rise, then our social conditions, the conditions we create around education, around child nutrition, and also, most importantly, around the opportunity for someone at the bottom to rise, to give them that opportunity. If you believe it's changeable, then you believe we can create the conditions to change it and to spread opportunity. If you don't believe it's changeable, then you really do get into the situation where at the end of the book, Charles is basically saying the only thing that's going to help is if these elites decide that they kind of care about the rest of the country, voluntarily do something, and I'm not even sure what that something is. If you don't believe it can be changed, then you're stuck. Then there's nothing about our social arrangements really matter.
Let me get a call right here from
Joe. I have no argument at all with the idea of better child nutrition and better educational opportunities and all the rest. I have no problem with that at all.
How do you do it without government, though?
No, but you're a libertarian. The disagreement here is an empirical disagreement about how effective programs to do this have been. And we can argue about that. But I'm in favor of all of those things.
I mean, Ross Douthat, I'm sure you saw Charles on Sunday, conservative columnist of the New York Times, looks at this and he says, very excited by a lot of your analysis, but what's exasperating is that you're suggesting nothing to deal with it. And he's conservative, but he says, get in there, Let's look at tax structure to help people out. Let's look at family policy, more family leave and child tax credits. Let's look at our low wages and how we're going to deal with it. Incarceration rates. Let's work on this, not throw up our hands and become a kind of aristocracy with the begging for noblesse oblige.
Well, I'll tell you what. Insofar as the problem has been more closely examined, and people rush off to do their favorite kinds of social engineering, I will cheer them on from the sidelines, but I will also be awaiting the results of their efforts, and based on past experience, I'm not going to be optimistic. I refuse to provide a set of solutions that I don't believe in, and I have no solutions that I think are currently politically practicable that would work.
Let's go to Offie in Johnson, Vermont. Offie, you're on the air.
Hello. Hi, finally. Okay, I'm a black PhD, 74 years old, in Johnston, Vermont, and I teach in a college up here.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
And first of all, there is such a thing as an isolated black elite also, like above me,
Really
isolated black. And I used Dr. Murray's book in my class, and I assign it as reading. I don't let the students know where I'm at all, and they discuss it, they write papers. At the end of the semester, I might tell them how I really feel about the book, okay?
Okay.
Which
book? Are you talking Bell Curve or what, Charles?
The Bell Curve.
Yeah.
But my main thesis is what I'm calling about. I'm saying that lifestyle matters more than race, ethnicity, or economic class. Lifestyle is the thing that is the most important thing. We have to quit talking about race altogether because lifestyle goes right across race. Like, the Obama phenomenon can only be understood if we view his acceptance as an acceptance of a preferred lifestyle.
So do you see then a collapse of virtue, the kind Charles Murray's talking about, as a cause of...
Why do you think the people who are considered poor white trash can still love Obama? Because of his lifestyle, because of he's articulate, he's clean cut, he's nice looking.
He's married. He has a family.
He has a good family, and he's somewhat religious, okay? He cuts across the whole thing. And it's his lifestyle that is so attractive. It's more important than race, ethnicity, or economic class. We've been categorizing or generalizing people by race or ethnicity for centuries with the erroneous assumption that these vague and unclear classifications will yield correct and meaningful information to formulate successful policy.
I get it. So it's beyond race here, and Charles Murray is deliberately framing it kind of at least beyond minority race here. But what do you do with that, Offie? Our time is short. How do you improve then?
What the colleges are doing is you can get into 70 different colleges now, all the elitist colleges, if your income is below a certain percentage, okay? It's completely free at Harvard, under $60,000.
Yeah, if you can get in. But Charles Murray says you're less likely because you're not going to be raised in that family that's going to impart that to you, and so on we go with this gap. Where does this go, Charles Murray? Give us your long view. You've got a minute.
My long view, I'm afraid, is usually pessimistic. I think we're basically going to keep moving in the direction we are now, and we're going to essentially be much like Europe. I think the civic culture that has characterized the United States in the past is disappearing at the top and at the bottom. And as long as I'm in my gloomy mood, I will say that my vision for the future is maybe not so much Europe as Latin America, where you have the people who run the place up on the hill with their barbed wire on the fence, and you have the rest down below. That is probably too gloomy to end the show with.
Joan Walsh, we've got 10 seconds. What can we do?
I'm optimistic because Charles Murray's book will bring together the white working class and black people. Race has been very divisive in the Democratic Party, but now we know Republicans and libertarians say the same nasty things about white people, poor white people, and white working class people as they've been saying about black people for the last 50 years. So it's time for us to come together, not come apart.
Well, we'll see. Election year right here. Charles Murray's new book is Coming Apart. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Murray, and Joan Walsh at Salon.com. Thanks to you as well. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point.